Greetings, folks, from a very cold and snowy Salt Lake City. Welcome to the 76th episode of the Lessons from the Cockpit show. I'm your host, Mark Hasara, and for over 60 years, my passion has been everything aviation. I am an airplane nerd, and for over 24 years, I flew KC-135s in the United States Air Force, passing gas all over the world. On the Lessons from the Cockpit show, we interview some of the most intriguing and fascinating pilots, aircrew members, maintainers, and aviation enthusiasts from all over the world. We want to hear their very unique stories, but more importantly, what did they learn from these extreme and extraordinary military, commercial, and even general aviation flying events? Our purpose is to show how does the aviation world really work and increase critical thinking skills both in the air and on the ground. And some of the stories you're going to hear on our show are being told for the very first time. This episode of the Lessons from the Cockpit show is brought to you and supported by the book Tanker Pilot, Lessons from the Cockpit, found in all four formats on Amazon, hardback, softback, Kindle, and Audible. There are 32 incredible pictures that were taken during the events that are talked about in some of the chapter. Our show is also financially supported by Wall Pilot, custom aviation art for the walls of your home, office, or hangar. These are 4, 6, and 8 foot profiles of famous aircraft printed on vinyl that you can peel off and stick to any flat surface. And we found out they're weatherproof. So go to wallpilot.com and purchase a couple of these prints to help support our show. We are getting great reviews, not only of the book, but also these profiles that are extremely detailed. They even have the arming handles on the Sidewinder missiles on the F-15s. On today's show, I want to spend some time talking about what's going on in the Red Sea and the Gulf of Aden between a U.S. Navy battle group and what's going on with these Houthi rebels, and give you some pretty shocking numbers of the amount of commerce that goes through that area. And folks, back in 2002, I got called into a room to do contingency plans for Somalia and Yemen, and we're gonna talk about that. So, grab an adult beverage of your choice, sit down, strap in, and let's begin the Lessons from the Cockpit show and talk about Operation Prosperity Guardian. This is the first show back from the holidays. I hope all of you had a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. We did here as well, and I realize it's been a month since I've published an episode. And of course, I took some time off over the holidays to spend with family. I had all my kids in the house at one time, which, as you know, during the holidays is a blessing. Unfortunately, during this same time period, we had a family emergency. It is not life-threatening. It involved surgery. It did not involve me, but a member of my family. And we've had to do the hospital rotation and now the rehab facility rotation. And it's caused a little bit of stress, as you can imagine. But the person that was involved is in good spirits and in good health and on the road to recovery. So my apologies for not publishing an episode for over a month. On the 18th of December, 2023, United States Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin created a security force to end the blockade that Houthi rebels in Yemen had created to stop shipping going through the Red Sea through the Bab el-Mandeb Strait. To end this blockade, 20 nations are now part of this Joint Task Force, Combined Joint Task Force 153, that is now floating in the Gulf of Aden and in the Red Sea. This has become known as Operation Prosperity Guardian. Well, what exactly are we guarding? Let's take a look at the economic impacts of what is going through the Red Sea. And these statistics are going to amaze you, folks. There is $1 trillion annually of commerce that goes through the Gulf of Aden and the Red Sea. This is why you have all of this piracy along Somalia and Yemen coast. There is a lot of money that goes through here. On a daily basis, 50 to 60 ships per day go through the Bab el-Mandeb Strait. 12% of shipping traffic in the world goes through the Gulf of Aden and the Red Sea. 12%. 30% of the world's shipping containers go through the Red Sea and eventually through the Suez Canal. through the Mediterranean Sea and obviously to ports in around Europe. This blockade had caused the container price to go from $2,000 per container to $14,000 per container. Now, my brother-in-law owns a tent company, and he has confirmed to me that the price of containers has astronomically gone up. And he told me that he's paying about $18,000 per container for his tents now coming to Utah. There's been a pause by several of the larger shipping companies from going through the Suez Canal and the Red Sea. They're now taking the long route around the Horn of Africa, through the Indian Ocean, and then into the Pacific. This has added $1 million in fuel costs per ship and almost 10 days of transit time for each ship that is carrying these containers and is delivering stuff around the world. They have to add the cost of approximately 3 container ships a day because of the extra 9,000 miles that the trip is now going around the Horn of Africa. This has also had an effect on Brent crude prices, which have gone up from $71 a barrel to $78 per barrel. The bottleneck at the Bab al-Mandeb Strait has caused all of these problems, and the Houthis know this. This is why they're doing it. It's only 16 miles across. And you know what Bab al-Mandeb means? It means gate of tears, gate of lamentation, or gate of tears going through this strait. And this is the strait between Yemen and Djibouti, 16 miles. And of course, all of these costs are passed on to us as consumers. You don't think the Houthis know this? And the Houthis are backed by, of course, Iran. Iran is giving them all of this military equipment and material, and Iran is buying it because now they have all of this money, some of which the American government has given to them, to buy these missiles and arms from North Korea for a very long time. The Spanish Navy was in charge of the Combined Joint Task Force in December of 2002. And they were trying to stop all of this piracy that was going along the Gulf of Aden and the coast of Somalia. And we got really good intel that there was a ship that had left North Korea with arms on board. And if I'm not mistaken, we had one of our submarines that had been tailing this thing from the Pacific through the Indian Ocean. And finally, it was approaching Yemen and Somalia, and the Spaniards said, we're going to take it down. We're going to take this thing down. And I remember watching the UAV video of the Spanish Navy commandos boarding this North Korean ship. Well, they get on the ship, they get all the crew up to the bow and are holding them there. And of course, they begin the process of going through the ship. Initially, they didn't find anything, but then uncovering some stuff that were in the bottom in the hold, they found Scud missile parts and fuel tanks and all kinds of things for Scud missiles that was bound for Yemen. So this stuff has been going on for 20 years, folks. Now, let's talk about, well, who are these Houthis? The Houthis was actually a family in northern Yemen, and they are Shia Islamic family. And they wanted to throw off all the oppression of the current president of Yemen. And these rebels went to war against the Yemeni government and were able to take over part of Yemen to include its capital. The Houthi Shia are, of course, aligned with the Shia of Iran. You know, some of you may have seen this banner that they have on their airplanes. And not too long ago, they had said in their press releases, you know, we're going to make the Gulf of Aden and the Red Sea a graveyard for American ships. And they made this commercial of this F-5E fighter taking off and flying low over Yemen, and all the troops are hooting and hollering. And it has this kind of banner on the side written in Arabic. And that banner says, first line, God is great. Second line, nothing new here, death to America. Third line, again, nothing new here, death to Israel. Fourth line, curse upon the Jews. Last line, victory to Islam. This is all the same kind of Barbary pirate stuff that goes back to the 1800s and Captain Stephen Decatur on the USS Constitution. This is how long this has been going on. And the Houthis realize that they can kind of strangle the supply chain of the world because of the amount of commerce that goes through the Bab al-Mandeb Strait and up to the Suez Canal. And of course, their blockade is causing problems on the world economy. Now, we may not be feeling it now, but some of the articles I read says maybe in 6 months, certainly 12 months, we may be really feeling the price of crude oil and all of these containers that are carrying all kinds of consumer goods, not only from Europe into Asia, but the other way around. Now, let's look at some of the history of this particular area. Remember, the USS Cole was in the port of Aden when Al-Qaeda drove a small ship into the side of it and exploded, killing a bunch of our sailors. And all of you remember the pictures of the hole that was left in the USS Cole. And if it wasn't for the just tremendous acts of bravery and heroism of the crew to save the ship, which they did, that destroyer would be sitting on the bottom of the Gulf of Aden. But the crew was able to save the ship, and we were able to put it on a barge, bring it back to the States. And of now, of course, the USS Cole is back out doing its thing as an Arleigh Burke-class destroyer. I've been looking at a lot of maps of piracy in this area. And of course, in about the 2004 through 2008 timeframe, piracy was at its height and billions of dollars were being spent in ransom as Somali pirates and Yemeni pirates went out and took over ships and just said, okay, give us $1 million, $2 million and we'll release this thing back to you, because they knew that these shipping companies had a lot of money and that the manufacturers that had their stuff on the ship would pay the money. Well, we created a combined task force, naval task force called Task Force 150, that really knocked the piracy back in this area. There's been a rise of it recently, but most people think that it's not going to get to the level like it was during the 2004-2008 timeframe. The other part of this is, of course, Al-Qaeda in Yemen. I've told all of you, go and read the book Hunter Killer by Mark McCurley. He was the commander of one of the drone squadrons in the United States Air Force. They're flying Reapers and Predators at the time. And he goes through the airstrike with a drone and a Hellfire missile on a gentleman by the name of Anwar al-Awlaki, who was an American Al-Qaeda leader in Yemen. And when you read that book, he goes through how that strike took place and the intel they got, and of course the launch of the Hellfire that kills Anwar al-Awlaki. The other thing that we've got going on in our history, of course, is in Mogadishu, Black Hawk Down. All of you have seen the movie based on the book by Bowden and what happened down there. So we have a history of fighting piracy and Islamic extremists down here in this area. Oh, and one other thing I forgot about. The Saudis went to war against the Yemeni government during this Houthi rebellion. And when you go to Google Earth, and folks, Google Earth is a great, great intelligence tool. They have this thing that you can go look at certain areas, look back at a timeline, back into the history of a certain spot. And I'm going to talk about that here in a little bit. But when you go and you look at Google Earth, you'll find that we have some pretty incredible air bases throughout this area. Which brings me to my next point. I think it was in February of 2002. The Master Air Attack Plan cell leader at the time at the Prince Sultan Kayak was a B-2 weapons officer by the name of Mel Deal. His call sign was Sideshow. Sideshow has the distinction of flying one of the longest, if not the longest, B-2 mission ever during the war in Afghanistan. Sideshow and another pilot took off from Whiteman Air Force Base and headed east toward their targets in Afghanistan. Once they dropped on all of their targets in Afghanistan, they flew out and continued flying east, circumnavigating the globe. And I think Sideshow said they had 8 refuelings. And if I remember right, the total flying time for the mission was, I think, 44.2 hours with 2 pilots. And of course, how do they do that? Well, you know, there's a couple really intense periods during refueling and obviously over the target area. But about every 5 hours, they would get gas from tankers, and both of them have to be in the seat during that time. But after refueling, one would stay in the seat and one would sleep on their Chase lounge chairs that they bought at the local Walmart. And then the next refueling, they'd both be in the seat and they'd swap out then. But Sideshow says, "Hey, Sluggo, I need to talk to you." And I said, "Okay, what's up, Sideshow?" And sure enough, he gives me another mission planning exercise. I'm like, "Oh, great." He goes, "Sluggo, I need to know what the gas bill would be if we had contingencies in Yemen and Somalia." I said, "Sideshow, what's going on in Yemen and Somalia?" Reading some intelligence reports, I found out that a lot of the Al-Qaeda folks that were injured or just wanted to get away left Afghanistan, went to an island off of the coast of Somalia. I can't remember the name of it. We called it Gilligan's Island, for lack of a better term for it. And then they would go into the camps, the Al-Qaeda camps and terrorist training camps in Somalia and Yemen. And Sideshow told me, "Hey, we're going to go after these guys too." And I said, "Okay, so what are your requirements?" He says, "I need to know what the gas bill is going to be." And I said, "Okay, what are your requirements? What airplanes are we using? I need to know that." He goes, "Well, I don't know." "Well, Sideshow, I need to know what we're going to use." And he says, "Well, use what we're using now over Afghanistan." I said, "Okay, well, that's fighters coming out of Al Udeid, and that's, of course, bombers out of Diego, and we've got carriers." He says, "Yeah, that sounds like a pretty good mix." You know? I go, "Okay." So I went with the first plan, all bomber show. We had B-1s and B-52s that were flying out of Diego Garcia, which, of course, they could come right up into the Gulf of Aden and across Somalia if needed. And they were going to take on about 60,000 pounds each refueling. Their missions were going to be, I think it was about 9 to 11 hours long. So they would require 3 to 4 refuelings. And at the time period, we only had tankers at Diego Garcia. And this was our kind of foot in the door to see if we could get tankers and possibly bombers into Thumb Rate, Oman, which eventually we did. We actually passed around a letter that says, "Hey, if we're going to do this, can we get the Omani approval from the government to put B-1s and tankers in Thumb Rate?" Now, this would have been ideal for Yemen and for Somalia, because the B-1s and B-52s were only like 60 minutes away from the places that they were going to hold and wait for targets. Where were they going to hold? Well, of course, I had postured this thing saying, "Look, let's have the strikers just hang out with the tankers, and when they get tasking, They just come off the tanker orbit and head to their target area, drop their bombs, do their thing, and come back to the tankers. We called it being on the nipple. We created air refueling airspace and highway systems to move off the coast of Yemen, not over Yemen, because they had MiG-29s and some fighters and older SA-3s that weren't derelict. But Somalia was completely different. There was no air defenses over Somalia whatsoever. And we pretty much could put bombers and tankers anywhere we wanted. I had two guys working for me, the Tims, and I've talked about them before, Tim A and Golfing Tim, who were NASCAR fans. So we named all of the air refueling areas off the coast of Yemen, over the Gulf of Aden, and all of the air refueling anchor areas over Somalia, over these terrorist training camps, after NASCAR drivers. We named the roads and highways after NASCAR circuits, Talladega, Daytona, and that's what we went with. We did a hybrid of this also. Not only did we have the all-bomber show, but we did the same thing that we did in Anaconda. And this was the plan that helped us wrap our heads around the planning for Anaconda, which came like a week later. We said, okay, here's the all-bomber show. So we knew what the bombers were going to require to fly these missions over Yemen and Somalia. And we did a 2.0 plan, which was bombers and a carrier air wing. That carrier air wing was going to be placed off of the coast of Mogadishu. So we had another air refueling area about 20 miles east of Mogadishu. So even the tankers could see the conflagration that we were going to cause in Mogadishu, or as we nicknamed it, the dish, because of Black Hawk Down. We were going to go in there and wipe these places out. And one of the other reasons I said, okay, let's put all of the air refueling areas over Somalia right over the top of these camps at 28,000 feet, because I knew that above 25,000 feet, looking at the weather, that the B-52s and B-1s that we were refueling and the KC-135s would have contrails behind them. And I wanted those people in those camps to see the bombers filling up on their energy drink, conning above them, and see the tanker and the bombers in their orbits causing these contrails so that they knew they're about to get schwacked. Now, we didn't have a name for this air war contingency plan, and we shelved it because we felt that our focus needed to be, of course, on Afghanistan and focus on the invasion of Iraq in March of 2003. So that plan stayed on the shelf. I remember a B-52 guy coming to me and goes, hey, we're thinking about going down and schwacking some of these camps in Somalia. And I said, got you covered. Here you are. Handed him the plan, the air refueling plan. And I remember him looking at me going, you can't possibly be this good. And I said, this is a question that we've been asking for a long time. If we could get permission to go after some of these places in Somalia and, of course, Yemen. And so we kept that plan in a safe. We didn't name it. It was just in the safe in a manila folder with a top secret cover in case we needed it. There was one thing we really wished we had at that time period, which we have now in spades. And that was Djibouti, the airport at Djibouti, in the country of Djibouti. At that time period, we had discussed, hey, can we like put some of our forces at this airport here, right on the coast of Djibouti in the capital city? And if we could get forces in there, man, the gas bill would go way down. But we didn't have the infrastructure there. The airfield was an international airport. It's got about a 10,000 foot runway, if I remember right. But we didn't have the ramp space or the taxiway space. And we certainly didn't have the taxiways and runway capable of taking like heavyweight airplanes like C-17s and C-5s to keep the place going. So we would have mog the place out. By mog, I mean maximum on ground of airplanes, particularly big airplanes. But now that has changed. Again, this is where you go to Google Earth and go and look at the international airport at Djibouti. And there's another airfield to the west called Chadbelly. And look at the history of these things. During about the 2011-2013 timeframe, we started building up Djibouti like crazy. And I'm talking big ramps, large, heavyweight ramps that can take C5s fully loaded to the gills and things like that. We didn't have that in the 2002-2003 timeframe like we do now. And I'll speak to this more in just a little bit. The Yemen plan, we were obviously going to hit the air bases real hard. They had MiG-29s, F-5s, and some older MiGs. It, of course, that air defense wasn't going to last long. And then we were going to go after all of the camps and everything that supported those terrorist training camps all out in the middle of the desert. The Somalia plan, as I mentioned, was again the same thing. We could see all the derelict SAM sites, but they weren't going to make any difference. They were all derelict. They didn't operate, and we could operate over Somalia with impunity. I think it was about this time, too, that there was another Al-Qaeda-aligned group. I think they're called Al-Shabaab. And, of course, they've been in the news the last couple of years, too. And they were just growing. So we were looking at this area, again, 2002-2003 timeframe. And finally, as I mentioned, in 2004, 2008, 2015, this became a very important area. And we started building things up. What was really fascinating was we began doing a really hard intelligence surveillance and reconnaissance soak of Yemen and Somalia. We started looking at putting, of course, Reaper and Predator drones down in the area. And Mark McCurley covers this whole buildup in this area in his book, Hunter Killer. That's why this book is on my reading list, folks. It really gives you a tremendous look on how the UAV world works and what their requirements are and what they need to be able to operate. So please go out and grab that book also. It's always been on my reading list. It's been on my reading list ever since the book came out. I read it in like 2 days. It was just a fascinating, fascinating read on how UAVs operate. I remember one thing that came from this, and that was the amount of Datsun King Cab trucks that were running around in Somalia and Yemen. Some of them had guns bolted to the floors. You've heard of the technicals. Obviously, in the movie Black Hawk Down, you see some of these technicals. Datsun white King Cab trucks seem to be the Al-Qaeda transportation choice. And I don't know why. I guess they're cheap and easy to work on. All we had to do was follow where all of these Datsun King Cab trucks were pooling. And sure enough, we were able to find where all these Al-Qaeda and Al-Shabaab folks were hanging out. A lot of these trucks were pooling in these three or four camps in Somalia. During our deliberations over this contingency plan, of course, we asked the question, what if we do a major air campaign down here? And asking ourselves, of course, you know, what are the intelligence tripwires that would cause us to go into Yemen and Somalia and start bombing these places? And the economic impacts of ships going through the Bab al-Mandeb Strait into the Red Sea was, of course, one of the biggest triggers. That wasn't happening in 2002 and 2003 like it is now. But we knew at some point in time this place was going to heat up because we were able to establish patterns of life in the 2003-2005 timeframe of who was moving into this area and how these Islamic groups were growing. The only way that we could combat this is it was going to have to be a joint fight, where the Air Force had intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance airplanes, tankers, MCAC-130s, bombers, possibly fighters that were down here based at some place. We didn't know where. And again, this is what caused us to look at expanding the infrastructure at Djibouti. And we looked at, of course, the three pillars of air power, and that is, as I've always told you, joint integrated fires, persistent intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance, and continuous humanitarian operations, because there was a huge humanitarian crisis that was going on, obviously, in Yemen. And how could we use that humanitarian crisis to win the hearts and minds of the Yemeni population by bringing in food, water, medicine, and so forth to help change the hearts and minds of those people there? Those three things were prevalent in our minds as we're putting this plan together. We already knew that they had Scud missiles, so we already knew, all right, we're going to have to fight mobile theater ballistic missiles again. We found cruise missiles parts on that North Korean ship. We're going to have to deal with mobile cruise missiles. And these are all the same target sets we're dealing with now that the Operation Prosperity Guardian Naval Task Force and the coalition partners, these 20 coalition partners, are having to deal with now. This is really interesting because it actually mirrored something we did at the weapons school and a report that came out on a website called The Intercept. And it was a series of articles called The Drone Papers, and it really uncovered and lifted the lid on Obama's administration drone assassination program. And some whistleblowers came to The Intercept and gave them top secret classified information on how that drone program worked, to include where everybody was located at the time and where we were putting drones and bases throughout the area. The last 2 weeks of the U.S. Air Force's weapons school, which is 19 weeks, almost 6 months long, they have what's called, when I went through mission employment, it's now called advanced integration. During the sequestration period, they didn't have classes for a year. We have two classes that go through, and during that year that no weapons school classes were going through in the 18 different divisions, the commandant of the weapons school at that time period, an A-10 pilot, said, you know what? Colonel Mike Drowley said, let's take a look at how we do mission employment and advanced integration, and let's do our scenarios based on historical scenarios from our past. And so they had this kind of rewrite of advanced integration when school was out of session, and they came up with kind of a new way of doing advanced integration. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that's when it became known as advanced integration instead of mission employment, with these new scenarios that come out. Now, again, this goes for 2 weeks, and it follows a typical major air campaign in some location. And the first thing that we always do is what we call intelligence preparation of the battlefield. And the first scenario was designed for our reconnaissance, ISR folks, the UAV folks, to be in a scenario where they really have to do a hard look and collect on what is the battlefield going to look like in this upcoming mock war that we're about to have over the Nellis Range Complex. So the first scenario for all of the weapons school students when they begin advanced integration is the very first thing right out of the box is this intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance soak and the intelligence preparation of the battlefield, so that we can build for advanced integration. This is what the air order of battle looks like. This is what the ground order of battle looks like. And it's really intense because you've got the J-STARS, you've got the rivet joint, you've got all the UAVs, you've got all of these intelligence analysts that are poring over all of this information that's coming in from, and I think they even have U-2s and other aircraft that are involved. And they do this huge intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance soak, the Nellis range. What kind of SAMs are out there? What kind of fighters are we going to be up against? What's the enemy ground order of battle look like? All of these different kinds of things. And that's the very first scenario that all of the students face in the Weapons School Advanced Integration. One of the other scenarios for advanced integration is designed for the students to, in a three-hour vol period, go out and find mobile theater ballistic missiles, mobile cruise missiles out on the range. And the historical context for this actually comes from World War II, and it's called Operation Crossbow. And that was our war plan, contingency plan during World War II, to go find all the German V1 and V2 doodlebug launch sites and destroy them. And how do you find those things? Of course, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance plays a big role, but these targets are what we call time-sensitive targets because they're mobile. And you have to find these things, these V1, V2 sites, and destroy them and get rid of them, just like we had to do with mobile Scud launchers during Desert Storm. And that's also what this Operation Crossbow advanced integration scenario mimics. I think it was in the 2003 timeframe, I went to a conference on worldwide strike and attack, and I can't remember the name of it, but a gentleman from Montgomery, Alabama, one of our Air Force 60-pound brain folks, got up and gave a great speech on what he called the Afghan model. Those of you who have watched the movie 12 Strong know what I'm talking about. That is the Afghan model. You have air forces tied to your special operators that are running all over some country. The communications equipment and the laser and range finding, laser spotting equipment that can call out targets, just like you see in the movie 12 Strong. And I remember during the Iraq War, there was one group that you find very little about. I've gone and Googled Task Force 20 numerous times, and there's not much you can read about these. It was a Special Forces task force made up of Delta Force, SEAL Team 6, and British SAS folks. And it was led by the legendary Delta Force commander, Lieutenant Colonel Pete Blaber. And he talks about it in his book, The Men, the Mission, and Me. And there's another book I think all of you should go read. It's called Jawbreaker. It's about the CIA station chief in the very opening airstrikes of Afghanistan. And again, it's special operators running around with laser designators and radios calling out targets to B-52s and fighters overhead. And this Air Force 60-pound brain guy that was working down at either the Air War College, I can't remember what, was talking about, we'll never fight wars the same way again now that we understand this Afghan model of tying special forces to air forces. And Task Force 20 had its own air force. They actually took F-14s off of the USS Kitty Hawk out of Japan. They were Black Knight F-14A models from VF-154 and put them in Al Udeid. and they read the Tomcat guys and some of the F-15E guys and gals into all of these special programs that Task Force 20 was doing. And Task Force 20 had its own Air Force. And they were devastating to the Iraqis with these mobile soft teams running around finding leadership targets, ballistic missile targets, and other tasks that they were given. And they were really, really good at it. Matter of fact, Pete Blaber gave the Task Force 20 folks a nickname based on the movie Red Dawn. They called themselves the Wolverines, just like in the movie Red Dawn with Charlie Sheen, Patrick Swayze. You know, it's a great, great patriotic movie if you've never seen it. But that became the model for the Air Force, according to this gentleman, that we have special forces on the ground running around with radios and designators and calling out targets to the fighters and strikers above. Now, as you know, just recently, the United States Navy and the Brits struck targets in Yemen. And I just saw a graphic on this. There was like 22 F-18s and four Typhoons that were involved in this, along with the British tankers, the E-2 Hawkeye radar command and control planes, submarines launching Tomahawk land attack missiles. Same thing coming out of all of these destroyers, and they're attacking command and control, a lot of these mobile cruise missile and Scuds. And I'd be willing to bet that they use this Afghan soft tied with air power model to do this. And it's extremely effective. And if you read the book Jawbreaker, I think for 52 hours, this one CIA special operations team is up there in the mountains of Tora Bora, and they're just raining down fire in Tora Bora. I also want to give a shout out to one of the helicopter squadrons that is on the USS Eisenhower. Some Iranian patrol boats, four of them, with small arms on them, were out attacking some of these commercial ships. And the helicopters from the USS Eisenhower intercepted them and sank three of them. One of them got away, and I understand from Ward Carroll on his great podcast, he talks about how this went down, where they were actually firing Hellfire missiles and using 50 caliber machine guns to destroy these patrol boats. That brings me up to a very interesting subject, because we've been looking at how do we take on these Iranian swarms of patrol boats and dhows if they're ever to launch in the Persian Gulf, and of course now down here in the Gulf of Aden and the Red Sea. In the operational test and evaluation world, there's a thing that we call JCTD, and it stands for Joint Capabilities Technology Demonstration. And we'll have commanders that'll come to the operational test and evaluation squadron, which was my last assignment in the Air Force, and they will write these papers going, hey, here is a problem that we face on the battlefield. Is there some type of solution that we can come up with in the Air Force or as a joint force? And we do what's called a joint capabilities technology demonstration. And I have some knowledge of this. During my last assignment at the Operational Test and Evaluation Center headquarters, when I got there, the general that was the commander there, a two-star by the name of Scotty Scott, says, "Welcome to AFOTech, sluggo. You got all joint weapons." And I said, "Sir, I'm a tanker guy. I've never shot a missile, never dropped a bomb, never shot a gun at anything. I've passed gas into a lot of people that have, but I've never done this." And he goes, "But yeah, you're a weapons school grad. Even though your school hasn't been validated yet, you know this stuff because you've been through all the core classes and you know how all this works. And by the way, I don't know of anybody in this building that has the joint experience that you do that's been on aircraft carriers, cruisers, destroyers, even a submarine. So you have all joint weapons, which Sluggo is going to be the funnest job in the building. So don't knock it. I said, all right, boss. I got to my desk and my boss had put on my desk after this meeting, okay, Sluggo, here's your programs. When you've got like 7 or 8 folders on your desk, how do you pick the first one you want to go through? Well, that's easy. You pick the thickest one. And there was one particular folder in this pile, had a secret cover sheet on it because it had intelligence data in it. And I pulled it out and started going through it. And the very first thing I see is a letter from then Lieutenant General Dave Deptula. And he was the current vice commander of Pacific Air Forces. And he had a problem that he wanted us all to look at. And that was, what happens if China invades Taiwan? How are we going to deal with all of the troop ships that are coming across the Formosa Straits and invading Taiwan? Is there some way that we can take these great new bombs, these JDAM, satellite-guided weapons, and make them hit not only stationary targets, but moving targets? And the Air Force's program was called AMSTI. AMSTI stood for Affordable Moving Surface Target Engagement. And we had a detachment that was down in Melbourne, Florida, that handled all of the E-8 Joint Star programs that worked for the Air Force's Operational Test Evaluation Center headquarters at Albuquerque. Both of these gentlemen were E-8 Joint Star folks, and they had this program. And they were trying to answer the mail from General Deptula. And I thought, you know what? I need to go down and talk to these guys. Went into my boss, Jim Ashley, and said, hey, Jim, I need to go down and talk to these Melbourne folks about this AMSTI program. He goes, okay, what are you thinking? And I said, Jim, there is no doubt in my mind that the Navy is looking at this same problem in some way, shape, or form. And what I'm proposing is we go talk to the Navy and find out if the Air Force and the Navy are looking at how we can attack moving surface targets and go through the whole weapon cycle, the whole kill chain cycle. Find, fix, track, target, engage, and assess moving ships with satellite-guided weapons. I said, Jim, I know that this letter from General Deptula has made it to the Navy, and I'm sure this is something they're looking at anyway, and probably have been looking at for a long time. He says, yeah, okay, go ahead. You know, get yourself a trip down there, talk to those guys and see what they say. I get down there on a Monday afternoon, and Tuesday morning, I meet with a major and a captain. I can't remember their names. And I said, okay, I've got joint weapons. You guys are working on this AMSTI thing. Talk to me about what it is and what you're trying to do here. And they went through everything that they were trying to do with the E-8 Joint Stars, what they call J-Series messages to Joint Direct Attack Munitions, satellite-guided weapons in flight so that they would hit moving surface targets. And I asked the question at the end of our discussion when they told me what the program was. Who have you talked to in the Navy about this? Well, Sluggo, we don't know if the Navy even has a program for this. And I said, do you have any Navy contacts that you have talked to? And they go, well, again, I'm a joint warfighter and I have a big joint Rolodex. So I call one of my F-14 buds and I say, hey, I know that you have the whole air warfare piece there's got to be a surface warfare group that looks at new technology, new tactics, and so forth. Who is it and where are they located? And Rolls tells me, oh, that would be Surface Warfare Development Group on Coronado Island in San Diego, California. And I said, do you happen to have a contact there that I can talk to? And he says, you know, I don't, but I can make a phone call real quick. And they're in the same building with some other folks of ours and get back to you. And I said, great. Rolls, can you do that for me? And sure enough, he called back a day later and said, Sluggo, this is the group you want to go talk to. Surface Warfare Development Group and Lieutenant Commander Russ. And now my J-Stars guys are looking at me like, okay, what did you just get us into? And I said, look, this is going to be great. Because you have to understand, when we move this from an Air Force program to a joint program, it comes out of a different pot of money. And if we're going to do a joint capabilities technology demonstration, that bucket of money is pretty big and it's pretty deep. And I said, we have to look at how not only we're going to do this with bombers, but our own fighters, and how we're going to integrate with the Navy, because when we're attacking ships, the Combined Forces Maritime Component Commander is the hammer. We support him. And there's a lot of doctrinal things that we're going to probably have to fix when we do this. And they say, okay, great. I come back from that trip and I tell Jim, I said, I need to go to San Diego to talk to Surface Warfare Development Group. They're called SWEDs. They're on Coronado Island in this building. He goes, okay. He goes, why? And I said, you need to see how the Navy works. And I'm going to get you on a bunch of different ships while we're down there so that you can experience this and understand how this is going to work. Well, we get down to Coronado Island. And again, it's all about your customers, folks. Even in the military and even in the business world, how are you going to satisfy your customer requirements? But more importantly, how are you going to find out what they even are? And that's what this meeting was all about. Lieutenant Commander Russ took this meeting, I think, with some fear and trepidation, like, what in the world does the Air Force guys want to come down and talk to me about hunting ships? And we had about a 2-hour long discussion with Lieutenant Commander Russ, with Jim, my boss, in the room. And it was a great discussion. And come to find out, sure enough, the Air Force's AMSTI program and the Navy's Joint Surface Warfare Initiative were working in parallel universes. The Air Force had a program, the Navy had a program. And I said, Russ, we got to combine our assets for this and our resources. Because as you know, if we can set up a joint capabilities technology demonstration, a JCTD, this comes out of a whole different pot of money. And we're going to be able to dip into that because it's joint. And Russ was all over that. So right there in Lieutenant Commander Russ's office, we took out a white sheet of paper out of his printer and started writing things down. What are our resources? What are our assets? Here's the Air Force assets. We've got B-52s. We've got F-15Es. We've got the E-8 joint stars. We've got the rivet joint. We've got, of course, all these other assets that we can use in this joint warfare fight. And oh, by the way, we're working on a new long-range joint standoff missile called AGM-158 JASM. And he looks at me and smiles. He goes, yeah, our version of it is called LRASM, Long Range Anti-Ship Missile. I left AFOTECH and the Air Force before this actual joint surface warfare, joint capabilities technology demonstration took place. I was told it was extremely successful. A B-52 dropped 3 2,000-pound satellite-guided bombs that hit an ex-Navy ship that was being towed, I think at 10 knots or something like that. and the bombs hit fore amidship and aft and blew the ship into like three pieces. And it sank in like under 10 minutes. And so now we had a way to do that. Not too long ago on my TikTok page, I put this up. They now have another, I guess, joint capabilities technology demonstration that was called Quick Strike, where an F-15E dropped a JDAM on a ship and it literally blew it in half. And we were able to go back and say to General Deptula and the PACAF and PACOM folks, I think we got a way to deal with all of these Chinese ships that are coming across. That initiative has gone a long way, and we realized that it wasn't only good for just ships. It was good to handle a lot of target sets, both on the water and on land. One of my AFOTEC buddies told me that this initiative went quite a ways. And now, of course, we have a capability of dealing with that. Well, there was another test that was done, again, in a joint environment where they said, okay, well, how are we going to handle all of these swarms of Iranian boats that are coming out and attacking our Navy ships going through the Strait of Hormuz? And they did another one of these joint capabilities technology demonstrations. And this one included the A-10 Hogs. And they found out from this JCTD, the A-10 Warthog is a fabulous. They also found out that using the CBU-105 sensor-fused weapon is also a great tool against swarms of boats that are coming out to attack Navy ships. And I recently saw an article in the U.S. Navy Times or something like that, where the USS Stethem, which is an Arleigh Burke-class destroyer, the P-8 Poseidon maritime patrol airplane, I think it was in September, in the Middle East, had a joint exercise where the A-10s were working with the USS Stethem and a P-8 Poseidon maritime patrol airplane. The Houthis out in these patrol boats are the perfect target for this joint surface warfare A-10 attack. Now, we call it close air support. The Navy calls it MAS, M-A-S, maritime air support. And they're synonymous with each other. And now we have A-10s that are in the Gulf, and we have the infrastructure to put them really close to the Bab al-Mandeb Strait and have them operate out of a place like Djibouti. I guess the lesson learned here is we have commanders that have very specific and unique problems that they will bring to the test and evaluation community and say, what kind of a solution can we come up with this? What kind of a solution can we come up to attack this problem? We did it for the cave complexes in Afghanistan too. They did a weapons test modeled after the caves in Afghanistan and found out, hey, we can fill a GBU-24 bunker buster laser-guided bomb with a fuel-air explosive and skip it into the back of a cave and take it out, because the fuel-air explosive fills the cave and ignites it. And, of course, the PSI and temperature increased like 100-fold. That actually was one of the weapons programs that was on my hard drive at AFOTEC. It had a cool name. It was called Divine Kingfisher. Whenever the Air Force has weapons tests that they do, it always has the divine prefix. But we were able to take these commanders' problems and figure them out. And we were given the latitude as captains, majors, and lieutenant colonels to put our collective brains together to come up with some really incredible solutions to some really hard problems. That was one of the great leadership lessons of my Air Force career, was having a colonel that I work for at AFOTEC say, all right, let's come up with a solution, see if we can figure it out. Then finding out the Air Force has a program, the Navy has a program, combining them, and it working out very well. When you come home from one of these trips, like I had with Surface Warfare Development Group and Lieutenant Commander Russ, you always have to write up an after-action report and send it to your boss. you know, hey, what did you do on this trip? And believe it or not, I still have that report and I keep it in a notebook with all of my OPRs and my transcripts from BYU and my master's degree. And I was reading through it the other day. It was just kind of interesting, a number of the issues that we're going to have to solve to make this work. And hopefully the command and control issues, how you're going to guide the weapons, who's going to guide the weapons, who's going to be the supported commander, who's going to be the supporting commanders, all that's obviously been worked through. And it's all come together down here in the Red Sea and the Gulf of Aden with the battle group admiral on board the USS Eisenhower, obviously, as the hammer for all of this. I mentioned earlier in this podcast that I had read the book Hunter Killer by Mark McCurley and gained a huge insight and admiration. Remotely piloted aircraft, whatever the buzzword is now that they call drone warfare. Not too long after I read the book, somebody told me, hey, you need to go to The Intercept and look up the series that they've just done, and it's called The Drone Papers. And it was describing during the Obama administration was basically the drone assassination program that helped us get Anwar al-Awlaki and a lot of these other Al-Qaeda bad guys. There was some missteps during this thing. I understand that, where we hit some targets that we shouldn't have based on some bad intelligence. But after reading Mark McCurley's book, Hunter Killer, and then reading, I think it's 5 articles on how they do the drone assassination program, it just fascinated me. I told you Google Earth is a great intelligence tool. And I went through the drone papers and looked up every one of the drone locations that the U.S. Air Force and our other government agencies, OGAs as they're called, were working from. Djibouti, obviously, was one of the big places in the drone papers. Mark McCurley talks about deploying there and operating from there, and the drone that actually shoots and kills Anwar al-Awlaki is a Djibouti-based and launched drone. But as you go around that area of Yemen and Somalia, you find out that there are other places they were doing this from. There had been a number of crashes of drones, U.S. Air Force Predator and Reaper drones, at Djibouti. The government of Djibouti was kind of getting upset. Hey, look, guys, we have to close this airport down every time you guys wreck one of your little toy airplanes. We need you to move. And they moved to an airbase that's called Chadbeli. And if you go on Google Earth and go west of Djibouti, you'll find this place. And it has a lot of drones there and is all built up. And when you use the little history tool where you can go back and look at pictures that were taken previous to whatever is the latest picture of Chadbeli, you can see when it was created all the way up to, I think the last one was in November of last year, and see where all of these drones are operating out of. And it's got a long runway. It's got a 9,000 foot runway, and so does Djibouti. And I think Djibouti's runway is 97 or 9,800 feet, which means it can take F-15Es. Now, let me talk about F-15Es for just a moment. I think it was about a year and a half ago, the Iranians were jacking up some of our ships going through the Strait of Hormuz, which of course is narrow between Iran and, is it the UAE, I believe? And that bottleneck was causing some problems. We had at the time F-15Es that were deployed to Al Udeid. I remember going through some of the news articles and it said, hey, F-15Es from Lakenheath are flying maritime close air support against Iranian patrol boats and gunboats, and it had pictures. And in the pictures, it had F-15E on the boom getting gas, and it had a really unique loadout. It was carrying four GBU-12 500-pound laser-guided bombs on the right CFT and three CBU-105 sensor-fused weapons on the bottom row of the left conformal fuel tank. But on the center line was this new tool that Strike Eagles are carrying, and it's called Dragon Eye, ANASQ-236 Dragon Eye. And it's like this all-seeing, actively electronically scanned array radar inside this pod that does synthetic aperture pictures, synthetic aperture radar, and they can data link all of the information off this pod. There's not a lot of information out there about this pod. They found that the F-15E is also a great tool for maritime air support loaded this way. And I found the picture the other day. I'll link it into the show notes so that you guys can see it. You know, all you plastic model builders out there now have a new weapons load that you can put on an F-15E Strike Eagle model kit with GBU-12s, the Dragon Eye pod, and CBU-105s. And apparently these CBU-105s are really good at even hunting down all of these patrol boats. Me personally, if I'm flying a hog, I've got that big gun out in front of me. The F-15E also has a gun. I don't think it holds a lot of rounds though, but these are all tools that we can use in this maritime fight in the Red Sea. As I went back and I looked at Djibouti and the history of Djibouti and the airfield there, I see MC-130s on the ramp. I see AC-130s on the ramp. There's tankers on the ramp, six of them to be exact, wingtip to wingtip. There is a lot of MV-22s. There's a lot of U-28s. There's also, what are they called? MC-12s that were on the ramp there. There is now the infrastructure at Djibouti for our forces to deploy in there and to fight here. I don't know if we've had any deployments into that airfield or not, but now we've got the infrastructure to do that. From the intercept that I found, one more really fascinating place that is out in the middle of the South Saudi desert, away from nowhere. When I first saw the name, I'm like, okay, this isn't like Somalia or Yemen. Where is this place? And it's called Umm al-Mela. And it's a border guard airfield with 98,000 feet of runway. And when I looked at it on Google Earth and did a timeline on it, where I went back to like 2000, 2001 or something like that, and went forward. Well, now it is one of our big UAV bases. Sure enough, on Google Earth, there was a picture of a Reaper drone being refueled. The satellite that took the picture of Umm al-Mela caught a Reaper drone with a gas truck behind it being refueled. And you can see all of the, they call launch and recovery elements. They're like trailers that have two command and control stations inside them at each end of the trailers, and there's a lot of them. And you see the same thing at Chad Belly. Chad Belly has now become our big UAV base there in Djibouti, again, because the government of Djibouti says, you guys got to move, and they move there. So when I talk about the three pillars of air power, joint integrated fires, meaning joint weapons, what tools and assets do we have down there, or potential assets that we can have for this Red Sea fight? Well, it includes F-16s, which have been on the ramp at Djibouti. It includes French Rafale fighters, which I saw on Google Earth, and all of these other airplanes that can operate out of there, that, what, maybe 10 minutes flying time from the Dab al-Mandeb Strait into the Red Sea? And you combine these jointly with the air wing on the USS Eisenhower. It's got four F-18 Super Hornet squadrons. One's a two-seat squadron and three single-seat squadron. VF-32 Swordsman is the two-seat squadron. I think 83, the Rampagers, is one of the single-seat squadrons. I can't remember the other ones off the top of my head. Two helicopter squadrons, an E-2 squadron, all on this deck. And to integrate all of those together, that brings a lot of firepower to the region. And as you saw, the Brits had their Typhoons down there. Don't know where they're operating them from. And of course, 20 some odd F-18 Super Hornets off of the USS Eisenhower striking all these targets in Yemen. And it wouldn't be anything to go south into Somalia, although I don't think that's in the cards right now. E-3, E-8 Joint Star size airplanes on this ramp at Djibouti. Again, it's huge. And there's other big ramps there. ISR platforms to include the E-8s going out of the fleet. They've flown their last operational mission. But of course, now you've got F-15Es and the F-16 too that are capable of carrying this Dragon eye pod on the center line that gives really good synthetic aperture radar pictures of ships on the surface, targets on the surface, whatever it might be, and can data link that out. AC-130 gunships, MC-130s are also in the mix. And of course, the special forces bring a very unique skill set in helping you find, fix, track, target, and engage mobile assets inside of Yemen and, of course, out in the ocean. Unfortunately, recently, two of our Navy SEALs are missing. We don't know if they're missing, if they're dead, but we haven't heard from them, nor have we found them. Being on the ground in enemy territory has high risk, but it also has very high payoff. And we found during the surge in Iraq, talking to Taz, my good friend who was in the strategy cell, said that when we tied full motion video to our ground troops and our SOF forces that were running around, helping us focus full motion video and our intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance assets onto specific targets and specific locations, we were devastating. Matter of fact, he told me, Sluggo, we were killing ISIS by the thousands, even the tens of thousands, once we did that. The last piece of this I want to talk about, of course, all of this is tied to the current war between Hamas and Israel. And the Houthis say once the humanitarian relief is let through into Gaza by the Israelis, then we'll stop doing this. Well, the other day, Yemeni government and the Houthis said they shot down an F-22. Right. There's no F-22s even in the area. It is impossible to prognosticate where this is going to go. Every time we hit something hard in Yemen, the Iranians hit hard at our infrastructure and bases in Iraq. They've shot missiles and done all kinds of things to the troops that we have in Iraq. And of course, that means that they're going to try stuff, of course, in the Persian Gulf. We had a U.S. cargo container ship that got hit by one of these ballistic missiles fired out of Yemen. This is ratcheting up. And folks, I am the last person that wants to see World War III, where we have troops in the Ukraine-Russia fight, we have troops in the Middle East fight, and troops and assets in the South China Sea. But I've said here on this show before, I feel that we are in the beginning stages of what could possibly become World War III, with some devastating effects, not only our enemies, but potentially us. And have been talking on the news, have said, we've got Iranians, we've got Hamas, we've got Houthis inside the United States. Where? I don't know. What are they going to do? This is why I feel, folks, that we are in a very tenuous situation. Operations going on in the Red Sea and the Gulf of Aden. and potential problems in the South China Sea, where once again, trillions of dollars are going through the South China Sea. And now the Chinese have all of these bases on these sandbars with 9,000 foot runways, bomber capable. And again, on Google Earth, you can go look at French frigate shoals, excuse me, not French frigate shoals, but some shoals down in the South China Sea. And there it is, an Su-27 on the engine run-up pad. We are in some very tenuous times, folks. And I think my lessons learned are these. We have to understand our enemy, just like Sun Tzu said. We know the capabilities of our enemies, but we need to be better at figuring out what are their intentions. We have been fighting as a joint force for a very long time. The troops are tired and recruiting is down, which is not good for the American forces. Another lessons learned. We are 30 plus trillion dollars in debt, and a country cannot survive that and go into a series of war or a world war with that kind of debt. We have an invasion here at home. I am not anti-immigrant, but I am against open borders and not knowing who is coming across our borders. On the plus side, we have the greatest military the world has ever seen. We are a compassionate military also. Don't forget that. There's a lot of talking heads out there saying, oh, we're bombing civilians and we're supporting the Israelis who are bombing civilians and doing all these things. Don't believe any of that. I never will believe any of that. I don't believe anything the mainstream media tells me anyway. We are a compassionate force, but we are the world's most powerful fighting force. But I worry about how healthy we are right now. There is another lesson learned here. We have a great opportunity to do humanitarian service and humanitarian operations in all of these regions. I mentioned that there was a terrible chronic food shortage in Yemen and humanitarian suffering. And we have the capacity of the United States to go in and help that. Yes, the Houthis are our current adversary. Not all of Yemen is Houthi. Let's take the opportunity to do humanitarian operations. And remember these three things: joint integrated fires, persistent intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance, continuous humanitarian operations. All of our air operations and ground operations and surface operations stand on that three-legged stool. I want to thank all of you for downloading and listening to this and the previous 75 episodes of the Lessons from the Cockpit show. I appreciate all of you who are avid listeners. Write to me and tell me, hey, this is a great show. When are we going to hear from you again? My apologies for taking a month off, but I did it for the holidays. Coming out of the holidays, did not expect a member of my family to have a medical emergency. You know, falling at 1 o'clock in the morning. Those of you who have dealt with older parents know exactly what I'm talking about. The prognosis is very good. That person is up and walking in a rehabilitation center and is doing extremely well. We're on the rotation of visiting, as you know, taking care of the situation. And that's why I didn't get this out for 2 weeks. But I appreciate all of you staying here with me and listening to this show and previous shows. This and previous episodes of the Lessons from the Cockpit show can be found on my website at markhasara.com. We are in the midst of building a Lessons from the Cockpit.show website. partially up. We've got a few things more to do to it, but you'll be able to download all 76 episodes there. This show was sponsored by the book Tanker Pilot, Lessons from the Cockpit, which is found on Amazon in all four formats, hardback, softback, Kindle, and Audible. The Kindle and Audible versions come with an extra file that you download that have the 32 pictures in it. The softback version has the pictures in black and white, just a heads up. And we are also sponsored by Wall Pilot, custom aviation art for the walls of your home, office, or hangar. There's 137 ready-to-print 4, 6, and 8-foot prints that you peel off and stick to any flat surface. And you really need to go see these because they're really, really highly detailed. There's four of us that work on these things, and I'd appreciate you going by and taking a look and buying one or two of these. We also do custom orders. If you want a custom F-15E with your name on it from a particular unit with a particular tail code and weapons load on it, fill out the form at wallpilot.com and we can make it for you. Folks, thanks once again for downloading and listening to this episode, and we will talk to you once again next week on the Lessons from the Cockpit show.